The hippies present a social dilemma. The clothes they wear, the way they preach love as opposed to hate, peace as opposed to war.
Everywhere young people were turning on, dropping out. The hippies, pot, speed, acid, alcohol seemed to take a back seat.
You guys stare at that thing like the world is ending.
I think the world is ending.
Well, I think what they're doing is kind of beautiful.
Honey, are you doing drugs?
No, Mom, I'm not doing drugs. Please stop asking. Look, what I'm saying is that they want peace and love. Isn't that the same thing you want?
I think these kids need help.
What they need is a bath. I don't know if they can be helped.
See, and there's the problem. You're passing judgment on people you know nothing about. You've never even met a hippie.
I thought they didn't talk to squares. Didn't you say I'm square?
Then you are the very definition of a square.
I'll tell you what, when God walks in here, brings me a hippie, I'll ask him what it's all about, because I do not understand.
Maybe that's why your church is so empty.
Hey.
Need a ride?
Sure.
Cool cape.
Right on. I painted it myself.
Yeah.
I'm Lonnie.
I'm Jeanette.
Hey.
Hey. So where are you headed?
Coming down from San Francisco, spreading the good news to whoever wants to hear it. How about you, Jeanette? You know about the way, the truth, and the life?
You've got to meet my dad.
Far out.
My stars.
Hi, Chuck Smith.
Who are you? How do you know my name?
Oh, your daughter told me, and when she picked me up.
You tell me right now where my daughter is. Jeanette!
What? Here.
Who is this?
It's Lonnie.
Hi.
Hi. Would you mind just stepping outside for a minute, mister?
Not at all. Frisbee, Lonnie Frisbee.
Frisbee. Thank you.
Sugar by any chance.
What is going on?
You said you wanted God to send you a hippie.
I said that, but I did not mean it.
I kept searching and searching. I just finally got to the end of it. And there was still a void. And my people, well, they're a desperate bunch. And desperation, man, there's power in that word. What would it take for you, Chuck Smith, to be desperate? I know we must seem pretty strange. But if you look a little deeper, if you look with love, you'll see a bunch of kids that are searching for all the right things, just in all the wrong places. So to answer your question, how do I describe my people? They're sheep without a shepherd, chasing hard after lies. And the trouble is, your people reject them. So I ask you, Pastor, how can they believe in the one of whom they have not heard? We can only walk through doors open to us. And your church? Well, that's a door that's shut.
Love is the answer, at least for most of the questions in my heart. Like, why are we here and where do we go? And knock on me so hard. It's not always easy, and sometimes life can be deceiving. I'll tell you one thing, it's always better when we're together. Well, it's always better when we're together. Yeah, it's always better when we're together.
I said it, but I did not mean it. If you haven't seen Jesus Revolution, I'd highly recommend it. It's based on a true story. Three men who were all searching for something. something more than what they had ever experienced in their life and found it in Jesus Christ. But they found it all in a way that they never thought possible. They weren't searching for this exact thing, but they found it in the love of God. And it forever changed their lives, and it changed the direction of a nation for a while. And I wonder today if we just say a lot of things that we don't really mean, and as God is always trying to get our attention, God is always trying to get us to do something, and we just miss what He's trying to do. You see, much of our life, much of this journey, is based on what we think. And most of what we think, if we've not been intentionally changing that or allowing God to change that, most, if not all, of what we think is based on this world. It is based on our upbringing. How many would just say right now that, and this isn't a knock against parents. Parents, we just do what we know to do. We just model what was modeled to us. But how many of us would just admit this morning and say that what we were taught when we were young just isn't right? Yeah, me too. And it's not just our parents, it's our school. It's our social interactions. It's our work environment. Everything about this life teaches us to be conformed to a culture instead of formed to God. Everything. And because of that, when we grow up and we start getting into different things, I was raised in church. And I'll just say this, everything, not everything, but in my terms, everything I learned and understood in church was contrary to what God wanted me to think. You see, I was raised in a place where women only wore dresses. You had makeup on all the time. You didn't even wear dresses outside of church. Men, you had to have a specific haircut. You had to dress in a certain way. Oh, and by the way, we didn't talk to anybody that didn't dress exactly like we did. Now, I don't know about you, but that's not right. And it made me think about a lot of things about a lot of people that I should have never thought about. God has been in this business for so long. He's always been trying to change the way we think. Back in the Old Testament, when he was speaking through Isaiah the prophet to the nation of Israel, he would say this. In the beginning of chapter 55, he's writing to a people who are distressed, who are thirsty, who are hungry, who are looking for something different, looking for something more. He says these words, "For my thoughts are not your thoughts, and your ways are not my ways. As the heavens are higher than the earth, so are my ways higher than your ways, and my thoughts than your thoughts." You see, some things never change. When Jesus came onto the scene, they were still not thinking right. And so Jesus lived his life, and he converts a guy named Saul, and he becomes Paul. And Paul would write this in Romans chapter 12, verses 1 and 2. You see, Paul addresses the thought process of not just the Jews and the Gentiles, but the entire nations. He addresses the way that they thought that they had a relationship with God in the first 11 chapters. He deconstructs everything that they thought in those 11 chapters, and in chapter 12 becomes a transition or a pivotal point. He says these words, "Therefore, I urge you, brothers and sisters, in view of God's mercy." And in what he's talking about, in the first 11 chapters, you guys got it wrong and you deserve death. But because of God's mercy, you're sitting here today and you're listening to these words. It still applies, doesn't it? Because I know I deserve death. Because of that, because of God's mercies, I want you to offer your bodies as a living sacrifice, holy and pleasing to God. How do you do that? How do you live as a holy sacrifice? Well, he's going to tell you in the next couple of phrases. This is true and proper worship. Do not be conformed to the pattern of this world. Or, in other words, for the first 11 chapters, he's told you how your thinking is wrong and how to change your thinking. And now he's going to tell you, do not be conformed to the pattern of this world. Stop thinking like the culture that you're in. Stop thinking like the way that you've been taught. Stop thinking the things that this world has taught you because they do not align with my Father. And man, we need to grasp this because we have some stinking thinking. And he says, instead of this, be transformed by the renewing of your mind. In other words, change the way you think. How's that going to happen? God's going to walk you through that. He says, then and only then will you be able to test and approve what God's will is, his good, pleasing, and perfect will. You want to know what God's will is? Change the way you think. You know what God wants you to do? Change the way you think. Paul spent 11 chapters telling you got stinking thinking. And in one verse, he tells you to change it. Man, I wish it was that easy. Here's the problem. If it was that easy, we wouldn't get it, would we? We have to go through trials and tribulations, and we have to go through all these things because we got such hard heads. We have to understand more than just God changing the way we think. We have to learn to think a new way. So with all these thoughts in mind, allowing God to transform us through the way we think, we want to begin a series on the one another commands in the New Testament. There's some over 60 commands of one another. I will promise you we're not going to do a 60-part series. Sometimes I think it feels like that, but I promise you we're not going to do that. It's probably five sermons if I have to just guess right off the top of my head. The term one another is a reciprocal pronoun. What does that mean? Well, it means that if I do something for you, you automatically do something back for me. So how many have ever said, if you help me move, I'll help you move? And so you show up and help them move on that day. You change your schedule. You do all this stuff. And when it's time for you to move, yeah, exactly, crickets, right? That's not one another. That's the way the world has taught us to think, right? As long as you help me, when it comes time that you need help, I may or may not be there. That's not the term one another. That's what the world does. How about this one? You scratch my back, except when it comes to money. Right? I mean, these are things that the world teaches us, and when we're Christians, God is literally saying, that's not the way it should be. We should be better than this. In fact, for us as a community of believers, it is essential to life and community together that we live out these one another commands. That's what makes us different than all the rest of the world. In fact, Jesus lived his entire life living out these commands and showing the people around him who would listen, who would have ears to hear and hearts to receive a different way of thinking and a different way of life. He gives this command at the end of his ministry with the 12. In fact, now there's only 11 in John chapter 13. We go through the supper. It comes time for Judas to disappear. And as soon as Judas is gone, Jesus gives the disciples a new command. He says this in John 13:31. When he, Judas, was gone, Jesus said, now the Son of Man is glorified. What he means there is, it is now my time. I am going to go to the crucifixion. They don't understand it, but that's what he's literally saying. Now the Son of Man is glorified. And if I go and be crucified, God is glorified through him. And if or when God is glorified through him in the crucifixion, God will glorify the Son himself and will glorify him at once through the resurrection. So if I go to the cross, God is glorified. And if God is glorified, he will raise me from the dead. That's what he's saying in those verses. And then he goes on from there. My children, I will be with you only a little longer. You will look for me and you will, just as I told the Jews, so I tell you now, where I'm going, you cannot come. And I think this next passage, this next phrase, group of phrases, is the whole meaning behind this night. And they miss it. And we would have too. A new command I give you, love one another. As I have loved you, so you must love one another. By this, everyone will know that you are my disciples if you love one another, just as I have loved you. And so that becomes a question of how did Jesus love them? What did Jesus do that was different than the world around them was doing? And we can go back, and we don't have time to do a whole list of this, but just think about this. Jesus began his ministry with the Sermon on the Mount. And the Sermon on the Mount wasn't a one-time event. We believe that was like a traveling message. And so everywhere he would go, he would preach portions or all of this message over and over and over again. You know how you get somebody to remember something? Repetition. You just do it over and over and over. How many remember the multiplication tables in school? Over and over and over. 9 times 9 is 81. Some of y'all remember. What was your first home phone number? Most of us can say that. What's your current phone number? I have no earthly idea. It's in my phone. Why? Because it's not repetition. And so he would go through this. And so he would use these. And I don't have time to cover all this. The blessed person in the beginning of the Sermon on the Mount is the one who does not think more highly of himself than he should and who endures for righteousness' sake more than the world thinks he should. You see, we're taught to look out for number one and get all you can. Jesus says there's a better way. He goes from there and he literally says, if you will, you need to change the way you think. He says it in this phrase, you've heard it said, but I say unto you, over and over, what you have been taught and what God wants you to think, believe, and accomplish do not align. And we just really need to get to that point. It's not about murder. It's about loving others to the point of not even thinking about murder. It's not about adultery. It's about loving others to the point of not even considering, not even thinking about adultery. It's not about the enemy. It's about loving others to the point of praying for those that we think are enemies, like they're our very own neighbors. And you know, most of the time in our culture, they are. How many times has somebody moved in your neighborhood and you thought, well, there goes the neighborhood? Yeah, we laugh, and I think God cries. This ought to break us to the very core of who we are if we call ourselves Christians. What if life and loving is not about what we think it is? A few weeks ago, actually, plans of man, just in all honesty, I actually preached a portion, a similar sermon to start this off at CR a few weeks ago in case we didn't get back from the cruise in time. Little did we know, Mike was going to go down, Pastor April was going to have to preach, and Mike was going to cover the week that we came back. Just before I was able to preach that first time, ever since the pandemic, we've been buying Krispy Kreme donuts for our essential servants on Sunday morning, because for a while there, we weren't making, as Mike would say, home-cooked meals. And so we're buying Krispy Kremes. Now we've been doing it so long, everybody just kind of expects it. And so I always go to the same Krispy Kreme shop, and they do a fantastic job. And if you know today, the servant industry is getting beat up because they don't have enough workers, and everybody comes in there and just mean and nasty. And again, we need to be somebody that's different. God's created us to be somebody that's different. And so I went in there, and in our culture, we have a system that works like this. I give you money, and you give me goods or service, right? I'm not saying that's bad, just saying that's our culture. And when anything else happens, it's kind of contrary to culture, and it leaves people thinking, why, right? So I go in one morning, and they're having a bad morning, and I just talked to, I had been in there so many times, they know me, they know what I want, and I'm talking to the manager one morning, and I just said, hey, how can I help you honor those that work for you? And she looked at me with this puzzled look on her face. And I said, what about if I made barbecue? I said, I love to smoke meats. What if I just made some barbecue for you? Would you be able to, do you have a fridge? Would you be able to serve that to your folks throughout the day that they could just enjoy a meal? And she literally looked at me and she said, why would you do that? And I said, look, you guys do a fantastic job here every day. And people are beating you up left and right, and it's not your fault. You just need to know that we love you. And she said, yeah, if you want to do that, go ahead. So I did that just before I preached this. Unfortunately, she was on vacation that week, and they didn't save her any. Isn't that how life works? So I come in the next Sunday, and it's all about creating a relationship and a love, right? And so I come in, and I order, and there's a new lady there I hadn't seen before because this one was on vacation, and the assistant manager was in the back, and she hollers from the back, hey, thanks for the barbecue. I said, you're welcome. I think nothing about it. The lady that was there was participating in the barbecue, and she said, well, you brought the barbecue? I said, yeah. I said, I just want to love on you guys a little bit. And she said, well, I'm going to give you 4 free cinnamon rolls. I said, no, you're not. And she said, what? I said, I didn't do it to get anything free. I did it to love on you. And I won't take anything free because it's a gift to you. Now, what if we just kind of changed the way people thought about life by the way that we treat them? It's not about an exchange for goods. I'm a part of a Facebook group. I know we're not supposed to be on there, but I'm part of a Facebook group called First Time Pool Owners. I bought a house a few years ago that has a pool, and I had no clue other than what Mike Owen helped me learn. And so I get on there, and I watch all these things. And one lady was having a pool built, and she makes a comment, and she says, you know, I have all these people out back working on this pool. I wonder if it'd be okay if I gave them food and drink during the day to honor them. In the comments. Atrocious. Why would you do that? You're already paying outrageous amounts of money. These people, they already get paid for all that. And just over and over and over. And I just simply responded and I said, hey, maybe you ought to do what God's asking you to do. And love on these people regardless of how you pay them. You know, today, we'll most of us, how many will go out to eat today? All right, be honest. Most of us are going to go out to eat today. You know, today is the worst day for servers. Their worst tips are on Sunday. You want to know why? Church people. You think I'm joking. We are the most vile, ugliest, nastiest, judgmental people because we tip based on how well we're served. Man, what if God did that with us? Ouch. Right? Ouch. What if what we think about love is just not right? I don't have time. John chapter 3 and John chapter 4 are bookends for me for salvation, for approaching people. He takes two enemies that the disciples have come to be taught about, the Jewish leaders and the Samaritans, and he allows a Jewish leader to come and carries on a conversation with him, has dinner with him, and he goes to Samaria. He says, not that he just goes, he says, I have to go to Samaria. And so he destroys this enemy teaching for the disciples. Not only does he that, he touches the untouchables, the lepers, the sick, the lame, the blind. He approaches the unthinkable, the Samaritans, the pagans, the possessed. He corrects the uncorrectable, the religious leaders, the money changers in the temple, and the woman caught in the act of adultery. And he just literally dismantles everything that these people have been taught to think about who God is and what God wants in their life. And if you just go back and you just do a survey of that, he just literally obliterates their thought process. Just shows over and over, love is a choice and an action aligning with God's thoughts and desires. That's what we're called to do. And now let's just go back to Peter. He's given this command and he goes back to Peter and Peter makes, Peter's a slow learner. Anybody relate? I can relate to Peter. I just really can. John chapter 13, 36, Peter says this, where are you going that I cannot come? Totally misses the point. I'm giving you a new command. I'm giving you a new direction. I'm giving you a new mission. Simply love people. Where are you going that I can't go? You see, based on what he was taught, based on all that he knew, the Messiah, who Jesus was to be a king, a conquering king, and you can't go anywhere that we don't go with you because we're just supposed to go to battle. And that's what he was thinking. He misses it. Jesus knows Peter, and he knows us, and I'm so thankful for it. Peter's always putting his foot in his mouth, and so Jesus knows it will take a significant event for Peter to come around. I don't have time this morning, but I've had significant events in my life. The first one, and I don't have time to cover it all, was God broke my wife's leg. I knew God had been speaking to me. I knew God had been searching after me. I knew God had been running after me, and he broke her leg. How do I know that? Because as soon as it happened, this is the voice that came into my head. What else is it going to take for me to get your attention? I'm begging you this morning, if God is speaking to you, don't make him have to bring a significant event in your life to get your attention. I've got more because I'm a slow learner, just like Peter. That was the worst. Why can't I go? Jesus says in John chapter 13, 37. Where I'm going, you cannot come. But you will follow me, Peter. Peter, Lord, why can't I follow you now? I'll lay down my life for you. And Jesus like, will you really lay your life down for me? I tell you, before the rooster crows, before this night is over, you'll disown me three times. You want to talk about a significant event? Here's a guy who's a zealot. He carries a sword. He's ready to go to war. He's ready to die. And here's his Messiah telling him, before this night's over, you'll die. You know what he thought? There ain't no way I'm going to deny you. They come to arrest Jesus. Peter pulls out his sword. He goes to cut somebody's head off and misses. Glad he's not on my team. I'm just being honest. He cuts the guy's ear off. Jesus looks at Peter and says, put the sword away. I'm going to add some in here. Put the sword away, Peter. It's not about war. It's about love. And Jesus reached down, picked up the ear, puts it back on the guy's head and heals him. You want to think Peter started thinking about what he thought about? They all take off. Before the night's over, Peter denies Jesus three times. Cock crows. He leaves. It's interesting. There are four Gospels that describe this account. Three of the Gospels tell you what Peter does, and thinks immediately following this denial. This is what it says. Oh, I lost it. He immediately remembered Jesus' statement. What statement? You'll deny me before the night is over. And he goes outside the temple and he weeps bitterly. Wouldn't we all? Here's what John says. John is known as the disciple of love, and his gospel is known as the gospel of love. And here's what his says. That's right, he didn't say anything about it. So I asked myself, why is that? Here's what I came up with. You see, when we love one another and we know the pain someone is in because of poor choices, love doesn't bring it up. I may not be able to take the pain away, but I shouldn't make it worse. We ought to take "I told you so" out of our vocabulary. I can't take your pain away, but I sure shouldn't make it worse. Peter, who denied Jesus, is now desperate. He doesn't know what to do, so he goes back to fishing. And in desperation, there is power. Resurrection happens. They haven't caught anything. Guy on the shore hollers out to the disciples in the boat and says, hey, cast your nets on the other side. Peter's experienced this before. You see, in his desperation, he takes off, or he actually puts on his clothes, he jumps in the water, and he swims to shore. He gets to Jesus, and he wants to say something. We don't know that he says anything, but wouldn't you want to say something like, hey, I am so sorry. I never should have doubted you. I will die for you, but I didn't die for you. I actually denied. You know, he wanted to say all those things, and Jesus looked at him and said, hey, you got anything to eat? Because people who are hungry can't think right. You think Snickers came up with that all on their own? Jesus literally says, let's have something to eat before we have a conversation. Because you don't think right when your belly's growling. Do you? I don't. When they get done, Jesus has a conversation. We've talked about it many times. Do you love me? Do you love me? Do you love me? Agape, agape, which is unconditional, unconditional. Do you love me like a brother? You know, so many times people, and I get it, the three go to the three denials. But I just wonder if there's more than that. I just wonder if Peter, in this process, thought back to that last night and thought, man, I missed it. What Jesus was literally asking and commanding me to do was to love in a different way. I thought love would be in a sword, and I thought love would be in war. But that's not what he's asked me to do. And I just wonder if he thought back. We started off with this video clip. Chuck Smith did something he never thought possible. He actually invited a hippie to come live with him. This is a true story. He allowed Jesus to teach him a different way to love. You never know what God might do when you learn to love one another as he loved us. I can't say any better than this movie does. Turn your attention to the screen again.
If you feel like you're an outcast, then join us here. If you feel like you're misunderstood and judged, this is where you belong. If you feel ashamed or trapped in something you've done or are doing, you will find forgiveness and freedom right here. No guilt trips. This is your home. And I want you to tell all your friends about it. There is a place for you. Now that door is open all the time for you, any time of day. And if there are some who don't like that, well then that door is open for you too. It works both ways.
Headed back to New York. You know when they gave me this story? I didn't want it. Kind of thought it was beneath me. I cover wars and riots and politics, important things. Hippies and Jesus. Now, man, I don't know. Our country is a dark and divided place. But in that tent, there's hope and unity and miracles. I can't even explain.
Oh, boy.
You're out past curfew. You okay?
Oh, I'm all right, babe. I know I've been distracted. I haven't been around a lot.
No,
lately.
Dad, stop. I have something that I want to say to you. See, I was almost done with this whole Christianity thing. I was like, where's the love, you know? What are we even doing here? Where is Jesus in all of this? He seemed like a radical dude. Like, I'd like him, but this, I don't know. But then you did what nobody else would even dare to do. You let the hippies in. Come to find out, Jesus came in with them. And you know what? I'm proud of you. You opened yourself up to something you didn't understand. And I'm changed because of it.
I personally am changed because of his love. Let's pray. Father, we love you. I always start my prayers that way. For years, I just want to remind myself how much I love you. And I only love you because you first loved me. And so, Father, this morning, I pray that you would change the way that we think so that we might know your good and perfect will. So that we might live a sacrificial life that demonstrates your love to each other, so that the world might know whose we are. As we enjoy this personal relationship with you, may they see the difference in us, and may they come to know that relationship too. We pray this in Christ's name. Amen.